Hello everyone, my name is Demismu and this is my assistant the Foot. Today we'll talk about Plato's theory of knowledge. In the last video, we already discussed his theory of the forms, and the two are closely linked, because for Plato, true knowledge is the knowledge of the forms. Forms are the perfect models for everything that exists. We gave the example of the form of dogness. All dogs have an eternal model of dogness above them, which they imitate and in which they participate. All beautiful things have the eternal model of beauty, and as long as they participate in this form, they remain beautiful. Forms or ideas are the unchanging models or essences of all things. To know something, to know what a dog is, it is not enough to know an individual dog, but the essence shared by all dogs. In the same way, knowledge of beauty is not to have seen something beautiful, but to have the knowledge of the form of beauty itself. Therefore, as discussed in the previous lecture, Plato divides existence into two worlds, the world of forms and the world of sensible things. He presents this division in his allegory of the divided line. The two worlds divide the line, and according to Plato, when it comes to the world of sensible things, we may only have belief about these things. Belief is just opinion. You see something beautiful and you think it is beautiful, but it's just your opinion. You may think that you know what a dog is, because you have seen many different dogs, but this is also just belief. Without the knowledge of the form of dogness itself, you could easily mistake a wolf for a dog. Adding to this the fact that things in the sensible world change, opinions are dependent on a specific time and space. Your opinion on something beautiful from yesterday may be different today. The lighting is different. It turns out that the shadows play the trickery on your eyes, and what you see today is not as beautiful as it was yesterday. Belief, just like the sensible things, is in a flux. It is dependent on appearance, on a specific time and space, and cannot be fixed. The knowledge of the forms, however, is the knowledge of the eternal, unchanging models that are beyond space and time. Knowledge is fixed and true for all time. This is why the portion on the line which represents the world of forms is larger. It signifies the clearest and truest knowledge. The portion which represents the sensible world, on the other hand, is smaller, because the knowledge of the sensible things can never be as clear and true as that of the forms. You can have only belief and opinion on sensible things. True knowledge is possible only of the forms. But what exactly does it mean to know the idea or the form? Well, according to Plato, knowledge is recollection. In other words, it is the process of remembering. Plato taught that the soul is immortal. The soul does not perish with the body, and indeed it existed before being confined to the material realm. Before it got stuck in a body, the soul traversed the world of forms. So it knows them, it saw them, it has the knowledge of them innately. When you learn something, you gain true knowledge of the form of the thing. But gaining knowledge is nothing else but the soul's remembering of what it already knows unconsciously. Put simply, Plato believed that the knowledge of the essences is a priori. It precedes experience and the sensible world. It is this knowledge of the form that allows you to recognize without any prior experience certain things as belonging to a given set. For example, when you recognize something as beautiful, it just comes natural to you to say, "Hey, this is beautiful." When this happens, you still do not know what beauty itself is. You still lack true knowledge of the form, but the fuzzy memory your soul has of the form of beauty still allows you to recognize beautiful things. And when you embark on the study of the form, this fuzzy memory is restored completely. You remember clearly what you already know. This is the beginning of a long-lasting division in the history of philosophy, between empiricism and idealism, between those who claim that knowledge comes only with experience and those who argue that certain forms of knowledge and ideas are innately present in our mind by default. And Plato, of course, is the exemplary idealist. This becomes more obvious when we turn to Plato's understanding of mathematics. Mathematical objects, the objects of geometry and arithmetic, are also types of forms, just like dogness or beauty. But for Plato, they represent a lower type of forms. The ideal realm of forms is itself divided into two realms, represented on the line. The realm of higher forms, the essences of all things and properties that exist, dogness, beauty and such, and then there are the lower types, which are not essences, but shapes and numbers. These are also forms, they are eternal models, but instead of having the form of dogness, the essence of what a dog is, you have a number and a shape. One dog expressed numerically and composed of different shapes, for example circles and squares, that can be expressed geometrically. And just like there is no perfect dog in the sensible world, there is no perfect circle in this world as well. But still, someone who had zero knowledge of geometry would still distinguish between something circular and something triangular. They would recognize it as different shapes, since the form of the circle and the triangle are innately present in their mind. When you put two and two together, you will always get four. You do not need anything from experience. This is eternally so in the world of forms. You might not be the best mathematician, but you would still differentiate two apples from three apples. The numerical forms are already present in your mind. So, the higher forms, the eternal essences of things and properties, as well as the lower forms, the perfect geometrical and arithmetical models, are objects of knowledge, true knowledge, which the soul already has in a fuzzy way, and which it can learn completely, becoming conscious of the forms. The higher forms are learned by what Plato calls reason, whereas the lower forms are objects of the understanding. Roughly speaking, the difference between reason and understanding is between wisdom and analytical thought. The knowledge of essences of things and properties is possessed by the philosopher, while mathematics, the knowledge of geometry and arithmetic, is the job of what today we would call a scientist. The sensible, visible world, on the other hand, is an object of belief and opinion, as we already said. But there are also different types of belief. Just like there are two realms of forms and two types of true knowledge, there are two realms of sensible things and two types of belief. There are the higher, true sensible things, which are copies of the forms. So the example we have been giving, individual dog, which imitates the eternal model of dogness. But there are also imitations of the sensible things themselves, a second order imitations. For example, reflection of material things, like a reflection of an individual dog in the water. But also illusions, false beliefs, unbased conjectures. And what Plato most likes to bring up, art, which instead of being an imitation of the idea of dogness, is an imitation of an individual dog. For example, when you paint or draw a dog in front of you. And this kind of knowledge is the lowest kind, imagination. So Plato, being a philosopher, was quite biased. Philosophical knowledge or wisdom is highest, belonging to the philosopher who is guided by reason, his object being the essences of all things and properties. Math is one step below, belonging to the scientist, guided by the understanding or analytical reasoning, his objects being geometrical and arithmetical forms. Belief and opinion are a lower kind of knowing, belonging to anyone and relating to the sensible things which are imitations of forms. Finally, imagination and illusion belonging to the artist deals with shadows of shadows, the lowest of the low, for they imitate what already are imitations. This is why their portion on the line is the smallest. Imagination and illusion are the types of knowing most further distance from clarity and truth. Plato was not a big fan of art. In the next video, we'll go more in depth on Plato's theory of knowledge by looking at the two other allegories that Plato uses to develop his theory, the allegory of the cave and the allegory of the sun. Thank you very much, and until next time.